Hello and welcome to the first round of the 2016 PCC Cup Series season here at Surfers Paradise. Let's take you through the grid. Starting on the pole is James Hewitt, taking the pole from Nicholas Corradovos in a surprising upset. Ike Durbin starts in row number two, driving for Manticore Engineering. Ramsey Cochiner, an excellent start for him here today. Third row is locked up by Ian Elias and Alina Lazareva, Gaspar de Souza, and our Lord and Savior Ben Atkins. Tom Delgado gets a new ride at Manticore Engineering alongside his teammate Louis Ballard. And going back further through the grid, you'll see a few familiar names. We've got Brian Gallagher there. Sapphire Anderson, the top qualifying rookie there in 14th place. The Kiwis looking for a very good run here in what can be considered her home race. Going back further, you've got Josh Marshall there. Chris Benson showed up without sponsorship. There's some rumors about that team. He might not last the whole season. His sponsorship bill is not very large this year. He has not been bringing a lot of cash to that team, so we're going to keep an eye on that team. Hopefully he'll get some sponsorship here soon, because that team is going to need it if he's going to stay in that ride. Kelly Blackwater is back for another year, very juvenile there. Candace Bowman, the best qualifying of the Zach Tech Motorsports team. Zach Tech and the Motorsports team merged in the offseason in accordance to the new three-car team rule. As we get towards the back of the field, we get some of the guys who were quite a bit off pace. Kyuga Hakai and Hank Jr. Wheatfarber not doing too well. And John Jefferson makes his first appearance abroad. Barney Ward crashed on his qualifying lap and was unable to set a time, so he will start at the back of the field. Now, on the start, James Hewitt pulls away from Nicholas Corradovos here. Coming into this first chicane, Ike Durbin now trying to move up to second following James Hewitt, and he's going to take the preferred line through the S's there, and it looks like Corradovos is going to have to fight with Ian Elias now, coming through that hairpin here. Ian Elias looks like he wasn't able to get the position away from Nicholas Corradovos, but James Hewitt now is pulling away from Ike Durbin. James Hewitt driving for Team Ben Atkins in his debut. He has won a race at Brno in 2014, and he's going to try to win here today. Oh, looks like we've got Lenny Jacobs and Josh Marshall made some contact, and Lenny Jacobs' car is injured. He's going to take his car into the pits this time. Kyle Bernhardt Jr. goes around on lap one as well, gets clipped by Barney Ward there, and he's going to continue on with a bit of damage. Looks like Josh Marshall getting into another bout here on lap number two with Mark Burt. They keep it together, but Mark Burt has a bit of hood damage there. Tom Delgado coming into the pits here on lap number two. He's got some right side damage that we missed. He got in an incident coming out of the S's on lap number one. James Hewitt now has pulled out to a pretty big lead now already on lap number four over Ike Durbin and Nicholas Corradovos. Corradovos is starting to catch Ike Durbin, and the top three have separated themselves from the rest of the field here. James Hewitt having a fantastic run so far, taking the pole away, and he is just doing a magnificent job in this 155 car for Team Ben Atkins. Barney Ward pulls into the pits on lap number four to repair that right side damage that we saw him get when Cale Bernhardt Jr. went around. Barney Ward was the only car not to set a time in qualifying. He started last. Mark Burt brings his car in to fix some hood damage, and he's going to come out in about 39th place. He has not had the best of debuts so far, driving for Double B Racing. Here's Louis Ballard back full-time in 2016, battling with Ramsey Cochiner for 6th position, and he's going to take that on the inside. They're going to be side-by-side coming through here. There's Gaspar de Souza in front of him in the 12 car, taking over for Kyle McWalla, and got a battle here side-by-side coming into the S's, and it looks like there's some contact there between Cochiner and Ballard, and they're going to keep battling. Here's Chris Benson pulling into the pits 55 car. That car was supposed to have sponsorship from the Stratosphere Casino, but for whatever reason, funding is starting to fall through for that. Considering he got this ride because of his sponsorship connections, that's not looking too good for his career. Here's Lenny Jacobs, who is about to be lapped here on lap number five, so that tells you just how much his day is going, and it sounds like he's got an engine problem too, because that car does not sound quite right whenever it goes by. Louis Ballard is taking the position away from Ramsey Cochiner here on lap number six. Ballard back full-time again, I mentioned, with Manticore Engineering, partnering with Ike Durbin and Tom Delgado. He's currently the second best running of the Manticore cars with Tom Delgado on alternate strategy. Ballard now trying to make a move on the inside of Gaspar D'Souza for fourth position. Actually, this is fifth position, excuse me. And, no, this is fourth. I'm mistaken. So, he takes a move there on the inside. I guess that was for fifth. Because here, he's making a pass on Ian Elias the next lap for fourth place. So Louis Ballard has one of the fastest cars on track. He's battling with Ian Elias there, who's got a Cedar Point deal. And that car is going to show a bunch of Cedar Fair Parks on the sides. It's actually a really nice sponsorship deal. And here they're just marketing the normal Cedar Point car. Oh, they make contact, and Ballard cuts through the S's there. A questionable maneuver, but I believe he's going to get away scot-free. Ian Elias battling with Gaspar D'Souza now for fourth position. They make contact too, as these drivers are not showing too much kindness to one of the local drivers here, Ian Elias, a native Aussie. John Jefferson in the 23 car is having a fantastic run, considering this is his first time outside the States. He is currently running 30th, and this car, this whole team, the Zach Tech Motorsports team, a merger of two teams, Zach Tech and the Motorsports team, this was an 11th hour deal, and considering that it's an 11th hour deal, he is doing fantastically. Louis Ballard brings his car into the pits on lap number 9 from 4th place. We're not quite sure why. Kind of a mindless strategy if you ask me. Here's James Hewitt, and he is up to a 7 second lead on lap number 10. He is doing a fantastic job here today, and I wouldn't be surprised if he just walked away from the rest of the field. The 8 car has dropped back to 23rd after his pit stop, and is going to have to work his way back through the field. Here's Scott Wullen, running in 10th place on lap number 10. Oh, he gets into the wall, and he goes around from 10th place, battling with Brian Gallagher. Scott Wullen running a retro Getty oil scheme for this year, and to be honest, it looks quite nice. He was battling with Brian Gallagher, who's running a Pokemon scheme, and next lap, it looks like Preston Bell's going to go around from 26th. Preston Bell running again for Steffens Racing. Ike Durbin's starting to lose a bit of ground to Nicholas Corradovos there, who you can see closing in just a little bit. Ike Durbin now with Manticore Engineering, hopefully getting away from Great Lakes Motorsports, will get him his first ever win. Looks like Lenny Jacobs is struggling with, lapped cars. And he holds up Greg Woodard, too. Lenny Jacobs probably should have just pulled that car off. That car is not handling well. And he is absolutely struggling around this track here today. Mark Burt and Barney Ward, oh, they're going to get together. And Mark Burt's going to go around on debut. This was from, I believe this was from about 30th position or so, considering both cars had been in the pits. There goes Tom Delgado, who was on an alternate strategy as well. And they're going to drop back. Here's Candace Bowman. That car is reporting some brake issues, and for whatever reason, she's going to slow down and stop on track. That car is going to get towed back to the pits, and they're going to get that car going again once they fix and replace the brake calipers. And there goes Ben Worthington from 27th place. Unfortunately, what was looking to be a decent run for this car is going to go up in smoke, and Ben Worthington will be the first retirement from this race. Unfortunate for Ben Worthington. He was having a decent run for that team. Duncan Cobb has some damage, and he's going to bring his car into the pits from 18th on lap number 14. Duncan Cobb, the hero of 2014, unfortunately, it doesn't look like he's going to start on quite such a high note. Now, James Hewitt starting to catch the back of the field, who came into the pits fairly early on. You can see there's a bunch of cars there. Some of those cars hadn't even been in the pits, like the 969 of Jerry Myatt, the 02 of Ryan Matthews. And these cars are going to go a lap down here. This is lap number 17 of 51. So these cars should probably pick up the pace of Ryan Matthews, not giving a very easy time to James Hewitt. He bumps him there in the turn, and he's going to try and stay on the lead lap. It's ultimately a vain effort, but he has the right to stay on the lead lap. Ultimately, Candace Bowman coming out of the pits. I believe she is 3 laps down currently, so a bad run turned worse for Candace Bowman as Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer blows a left rear tire. Luckily, he catches it, and he's going to limp his car back to the pits. Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer was picked up by Clayson Enterprises to drive the 70 car. That car he's going to just bring it to a stop there and get a tow back to the pits, and they're going to get that tire repaired. He stopped it there because I don't think he wanted that car to get too damaged. He's going to get going again here in a couple laps. James Hewitt working on lapping Chris Benson. Definitely extending his lead out. Here's Sapphire Anderson, native Kiwi, driving for Australian Motorsports in this number V car. It's listed as a 05 car, but the sponsor V Energy Drink wanted the number to be V, so here it is, the V car. Looking on board, Ike Durbin, and Durbin is catching James Hewitt very fast. Hewitt's having a very rough time working through traffic. He has lost 5 seconds to Ike Durbin in the past two laps. So now this is down to a 4-second lead, where it had previously been close to an 8-second lead before. So you can see James Hewitt way in the distance, but it looks like he's going to get caught here pretty soon. Here's Tom Delgado fighting, trying to stay from going a lap down with James Hewitt, battling on the inside, and he's going to pull it off. He's going to stay in front of James Hewitt and try and keep himself on the lead lap. Tom Delgado moves over from his own team to Manticore Engineering due to his large ego, apparently. That's what the team is telling me. He has a large enough ego to match the team. Sapphire Anderson gets involved with Lenny Jacobs, and she's going to go around and into the wall. And that's going to collect Tom Wilson there in the 31. Tom Wilson was having a fantastic run as well. Sapphire Anderson, unfortunately, some problems here early on debut, but she's going to keep her car going. We've got James Hewitt here trying to get around Kyuga Hakai. He's been trying to get around Kyuga Hakai for the past lap or so, but Kyuga's been holding up. There's Ike Durbin in the background. He is closing in. He is. This is down to a 2-second lead now, and it's not looking good for James Hewitt. He needs to get around these lapped cars as fast as possible if he's going to stand a chance of keeping the lead, and he hooks Kyuga Hakai into the wall. Kyuga Hakai has quite a bit of damage in that car, and he is going to go out of the race with that maneuver. Kyuga Hakai, granted, he was holding up the leader for over a lap and probably should have obeyed blue flags, and James Hewitt's going to bring his car into the pits here, kicking off green flag pit stops on lap number 22. You see a bunch of cars there following. Looks like Ike Durbin's in as well. Nicholas Cordovos is going to stay out and try to pull ahead based on pit strategy and get in front of the leaders. So Nicholas Cordovos throwing an alternate strategy, slightly trying to pit a bit later. Here comes James Hewitt coming out of the pits, and he's going to beat Ike Durbin out of the pits. Ike Durbin, well, he does beat Ike Durbin out of the pits. Ike Durbin's going to try to make it too wide, coming through the S's, but unfortunately for Ike Durbin, he loses out that battle, and James Hewitt is going to hold on to the lead here, coming into this hairpin turn and keep what may be the lead, potentially, as Nicholas Cordovos pulls into the pits. We'll see where he cycles out. Here comes Alina Lazareva, who stays out an extra lap. Two extra laps longer than I was expecting, and Alina Lazareva is going to lead one lap and collect a bonus point for that. The 2014 PCC Cup Series champion, Alina Lazareva, doing a pretty good job here today. She's been ranking in the top 10 all race. Nicholas Cordovos comes out of the pits, and there goes, there's James Hewitt. So Hewitt wins the battle off of pit road, but coming into the S's, Hewitt has to brake, and Nicholas Cordovos will take the lead on pit strategy. Louis Ballard is battling. Oh, Louis Ballard goes up in smoke from 20. He was in second place. He was in second place. He hadn't pit yet, so he was running right behind Alina Lazareva. And unfortunately for Louis Ballard, a promising run will go out the window with a blown motor. So now Alina Lazareva is coming into the pits and will surrender the lead to her teammate. We've got a battle for the lead. Actually, here it looks like Lenny Jacobs is holding up the leaders. Lenny Jacobs really needs to park that car, and James Hewitt will take the lead away from Nicholas Cordovos in what is shaping up to be a pretty big upset. There's the blown motor of Louis Ballard there on the inside, as Lenny Jacobs continuing to hold up Nicholas Cordovos. That car really needs to get off track as soon as possible, and they split him. There's Ike Durbin has moved his way into this battle. Tom Delgado brings his car into the pits from 13th place. He's going to need to hope that his strategy pays off if he's going to have any hope for a decent finish. Here's Ben Atkins, our lord and savior, praise be to Ben. He is running in 8th place and doing a fantastic job. Please don't smite. Please do not smite me, Ben. I wish the best to you. James Hewitt now struggling with Candace Bowman. Candace Bowman goes wide, and that's going to put a gap between Cordovos and Hewitt here on lap number 27, and 27 of 51, just past halfway. And James Hewitt's going to pull way out in front of Nicholas Cordovos. Candace Bowman blocking like most of the other lapped cars. Now a little bit behind this, here's Chris Benson and Barney Ward. Oh, Chris Benson goes around, and there's Ian Elias. Ian Elias is going to get into this, and so is Lino Zerva piles in, and Ben Atkins piles in. Oh no, God is dead! God is dead here at Surfer's Paradise. Looks like we've got Brian Gallagher in as well, going on board with Brian Gallagher in the Pokemon 20th Anniversary car. He goes through the S's, and he's going to try and avoid here, but the track is blocked. He cannot do anything to get around that, and Brian Gallagher is going to pile in and drop out of the race on lap number 27, going on board our Lord and Savior Ben Atkins, as unfortunately he sacrificed ourself to cleanse us of our sins. Ben Atkins goes out of the race. A tragedy here at Surfer's Paradise as we go on board with Andy Lambert, and Lambert's going to try and get through, but unfortunately he runs into Alino Zarifa. Tom Delgado blows up, running in 25th place. Looks like that alternate strategy isn't going to go through to the end for Tom Delgado. What looked to be a promising run for him, going on board with Gaspar D'Souza now. And, oh, he gets into Candace Bowman. Bowman goes into the wall as if her day couldn't get any worse, and she pulls into the pits. There goes Jerry Myatt, who's had a pretty clean day, to be entirely honest. Now, James Hewitt stuck behind Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer, who, if he saw what happened to Kyuga Hakai, he should probably get out of the way pretty quickly, as it looks like Cordovos is closing in. He is just two cars behind James Hewitt now, Joe Craig sitting in between them, and something breaks. I believe it's a fuel system problem with the Force 466 of Akio Gifu, and he pulls that car off to the side of the road, does a little bit of curb hopping, and he's going to make it back to the pits fine. Double B Motorsports has not had the best debut. Here is Daniel Sharp, who he has kept his car up in the top 20. Daniel Sharp is doing a fantastic job here today. And now we've got a battle for third place between Ike Durbin and Gaspar D'Souza. Looks like Bernfart Jr. is holding up D'Souza a bit. But somehow Gaspar D'Souza has kept up with Ike Durbin. And now he's going to challenge him for position. Although it looks like Bernfart's getting in the way quite a bit. The 16 car of Scott Wullen, despite spinning, is up to 7th place. He has had a fantastic run so far, and Tom Wilson in front of him as well has had a great run. He's running in 6th place in the 31. So both of these drivers really punching above their weight, doing a lot more than I expected them to here today. Here is, on lap 32, the battle for 10th place. Andy Lambert is continuing to go on, despite the damage. He was running in 7th place when he was involved in that incident, and now he's just trying to do damage control. And Frank Azzaretto is going to take 10th away from Andy Lambert here, coming onto the front straightaway on lap number 32 of 51. And it looks like Josh Marshall is going to challenge as well and take 11th place away as well. Oh, Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer goes around. He gets hooked by Ike Durbin, who understandably is frustrated with the temperament of all these lapped cars. Gaspar D'Souza is going to pull alongside of him and make a challenge for third place. Gaspar D'Souza has the preferred line coming through here, and D'Souza is going side by side with Ike Durbin. Oh, let's see here, going through the S's. Only one car can really fit through there, and D'Souza is going to take the position away. Now, Tom Wilson, I mentioned before, is having a fantastic run. The championship caliber test driver. He drove for Johnson Racing when they won their championships in the late 2000s. He was one of their lights drivers. And now he's getting a chance to prove himself in a full-time seat, and he's doing a fantastic job, running in 6th place. Another driver doing a fantastic job is Ramsey Cockener, who is currently running in 5th place. He has really distanced himself away from 6th. Looks like Hewitt's getting held up behind Barry Juveneau. Hewitt getting held up behind lap cars. What a surprise. As Korodovos is really starting to close in here. He's got quite a bit of a gap that he's closed in, and now he clears Barry Juveneau, but he is definitely struggling getting around these lap cars. James Hewitt is, as Josh Marshall has recovered, he has moved up into the 10th position. There's Sapphire Anderson behind him, and two cars behind Sapphire Anderson is Lewis Jones. So all three Australian Motorsports cars having fantastic runs here, running in the top 10. And James Hewitt now struggling to get around Dan Foray, as he does not have the preferred line going through here. Oh, he bumps into Dan Foray, telling Dan Foray to get out of his way. Really has not had very fun times with lapped cars here today, has James Hewitt. And ever looming in the background is Nicholas Korodovo, so perhaps he's starting to feel the pressure. Barbara Burt pulls into the pits. She is not having a great day either. She was running in 15th place, but unfortunately that's going to set her back quite a bit. As now, Korodovo's trying to make a move on the inside. Kelly Blackwater holding up James Hewitt. And Nicholas Korodovo's is going to make a pass for the lead. Korodovo's to the lead on lap number 40. As he's trying to battle alongside James Hewitt, who's going to get the preferred line going into the S's here. Let's see. Hewitt holding on to it, and still side by side. Kelly Blackwater's there, and Nicholas Korodovo's is still alongside, still battling. And oh, Kelly Blackwater, if Blackwater was not in the way, this battle would be over by now. But Kelly Blackwater continuing to hold up James Hewitt, and Nicholas Korodovo's will take the lead coming through here, this sequence of 90 degree turns. And James Hewitt, oh man, that is a tough break for Hewitt, as now Nicholas Korodovo's has pulled out to quite a big lead, coming up to Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer, who is all over the place, let's be honest here. That holds him up, and now James Hewitt is coming up. He will not be able to pass him, though. Duncan Cobb's day goes from bad to worse. He had an unscheduled pit stop, but now his car is breaking down. He has a tire going down on that car, and unfortunately, that's going to take him out of contention for a decent finish here today. Now, with 10 laps to go, here's the battle for 14th between Andy Lambert and Kurt Pliskin. Oh, it looks like Barney Ward gets into Kurt Pliskin, and they're going to go around. Kurt Pliskin was having a fantastic run, considering the strength of the Accelerator Motorsports cars, and it looks like he's going to get that car going without a problem, and here comes Nicholas Korodovo's to put him a lap down. So that tells you just how much Nicholas Korodovo's is pulled away from the field. Gaspar D'Souza kicks off, green flag, pit stops, the same lap, lap number 42, pitting from third place. Here comes Ramsey Cochiner from fifth, and we've also got Greg Woodard, who is running in the top 10, and Josh Marshall, Sapphire Anderson brings her car in, Frank Azzaretto. Looked like Lewis Jones stayed out there, but Nicholas Korodovo's, the next lap, kicks off his green flag pit. James Hewitt stays out an extra lap, trying to get around Hank Jr. Wheat Farmer, who has really been holding him up. I don't know. Look at the blue flags. Wheat Farmer Jr. should really get out of the way. And finally he does here, but he's still trying to overdrive his car, and he spins out like a dumbass. So way to go, Hank Wheat Farmer Jr. You really should not be in this car. And James Hewitt stays out an extra lap, trying to really pull ahead of Nicholas Korodovo's. He's trying to get a good advantage on his tires. And has Scott Wallen pit? Because Scott Wallen is currently running in third place. He is doing a fantastic job in this number 16 car. If he stays where he is and he can stretch fuel, he will be on the podium. As now Hewitt brings his car into the pits on lap number 44. And, Mark Burt's having problems. They're having a fuel system problem with that car. That's two of their cars now that's having a fuel system issue, and that car is not refiring. Mark Burt will drop out of the race here with just under 10 to go. There goes Nicholas Korodovo's, and James Hewitt will have to settle for second place here if he can run him down, which he's close enough to be able to do so. James Hewitt right on the bumper of Nicholas Korodovo's, and we're going to go on board with the third place driver here, Scott Wallen, who is within striking distance of the top two. So Scott Wallen coming through the S's. There's Candace Bowman right in front of him, but you can see the top two just a bit in the distance there. And Scott Wallen Oh man, if he can stay in third place, this would be a massive upset, as this, honestly, I didn't believe this car would even be contending for a top 10, let alone a podium here, coming through there, getting around Candace Bowman, as Corradovas has started to put a little bit of a gap between himself and James Hewitt. Hewitt's car seems to have good qualifying speed, but when it comes to race, he struggles to get around the lapped cars, while Corradovas is just all around a more consistent driver, it would appear. Scott Wallen's dream, unfortunately, does not happen, and he pulls his car into the pits with just three laps to go. Corradovas has pulled up quite a gap on James Hewitt now. He has pulled out to about a second and a half gap. He is also half a second a lap faster than James Hewitt, so it looks like Corradovas has this in the bag unless some lapped cars get in the way. Now, Australian Motorsports. Lewis Jones has leapfrogged his teammates, and they're currently running 10th, 11th, and 12th. So a fantastic showing for the home crowd, and also Alex Phillips, who is running in 6th place. And there you see Tom Wilson running right behind him in 7th. Phillips managed to leapfrog Wilson. And here we've got a battle for 4th place between Gaspar D'Souza and Scott Wallen. Oh, looks like D'Souza ran a bit wide, but Scott Wallen unfortunately does not have the speed to hold off D'Souza. He's really trying though there on the outside, but D'Souza is going to take the position here with just two laps to go, and it looks like Scott Wallen's still going to settle for a top five, but unfortunately it's not going to be what he's hoped. Oh, Josh Marshall just spun Dan Ferre. Dan Ferre is going to back into the wall. Unfortunately, his transmission is failing him, and he will not be able to get that car righted, and Dan Ferre will not complete the last lap, and it looks like Preston Bell's also having a problem on the last lap. Tire just went down on that number 75 car, and unfortunately he's going to drop out of the race before he makes it to the checkered flag. Coming through here, he was not having a great run anyways. He was running in about 25th position, but now coming through the final few turns, Nicholas Corradovas will not be held up by lap traffic. James Hewitt trying to do all he can, but unfortunately it's not going to be enough. And Nicholas Corradovas is going to kick off his 2016 season with a win here at Surfer's Paradise. Now taking a look at the rest of the top 20, Ike Durbin brings his car home in third place. I believe that's a career best run for him, if I'm not mistaken. Gaspar D'Souza got around Scott Wallen, as you saw earlier, to take fourth place. Scott Wallen, a fantastic showing in fifth place for Scott Wallen, proving that he really can hang with the big boys here. Alex Phillips and Tom Wilson, teammates, finished 6th and 7th. Fantastic runs for them. Ramsey Cochiner on Nice Cock Racing's debut brings that car home in 8th place, giving them a nice top 10. Greg Woodard has a quiet run, finishes in 9th place. Great run for him. Australian Motorsports, 10, 11, and 12, with Sapphire Anderson being rookie of the race, finishing in 11th place. Frank Azzaretto returns full-time, finishes in 13th. A fantastic run for him. Daniel Sharp stayed out of trouble all day with a pretty slow car. He qualified mid-30s and brings that car home in 14th place. A top 15 is quite a feat for him. Looks like Kurt Pliskin in 15th despite his spin. Kelly Blackwater stayed out of trouble all day and finished 16th. Barry Juveno had a few issues and brought his car home in 18th place. Looks like Andy Lambert in 18th despite all of his damage. Barbara Burt, despite her unscheduled pit stop, finishes in 19th, and Joe Craig had a very quiet run and brought his car home in 20th place. Now taking a look at the team standings, Australian Motorsports capitalizes on their 10-11-12 finish and takes the lead in the team championship. Johnson Racing finishes in 2nd place after round 1 on the strength of Phillips and Wilson. Nice Cock Racing in 3rd, ROG Motorsports in 4th, Accelerator Motorsports in 5th. Going through, Griffith Motorsports struggled a bit with their two other drivers. And the teams that are in relegation status as of right now are Steffens Racing, Zach Tech Motorsports Team, and Clayson Enterprises, rounding out the bottom with a combined total of 33 points. Next week, all three PCC series will take on the 1 Mile Oval at Phoenix, so we'll catch you next time.